And gentlemen, it's so nice to see all of you registered for the wonderful masterclass that we are going to have today. This masterclass has been named as Connecting Classrooms, Rooms with a View. This promises to be a session on virtual classrooms and online learning being joyful and engaging for both teachers and learners that will help us navigate the new normal and learn that acceptance is the road to recovery. The post-COVID education scenario is a pressure cooker world fraught with fear, containment, and a blur of frantic action with no roadmaps. There is so much newness to navigate, but also mystery and magic waiting to be discovered with the right operating manual and mentoring in place. Open the windows to the virtual world and let the view take you by the surprise. In the words of by a famous author, I write, erase, rewrite, erase again, and then a poppy blooms. Let us watch the poppies bloom outside our virtual window. Let me help you to create rooms with a view by our facilitator for the day's webinar, Mrs. Anjana Saha. Besides being extremely talented principal of Mahadevi Birla World Academy, Kolkata, she is very passionate about her subject English and has undergone numerous trainings by the Royal Shakespeare Company, UK. Mrs. Saha has received a national award given by CBSE in public recognition of recipients' valuable and commendable services rendered to the community for the cause of education as a principal of outstanding merit. She is also awarded the Jewel of Bengal Award by the International Institute of Hotel Management in recognition of efforts and collaboration with the Fourth Soldier Initiative for a Hunger-Free Bengal in January 2020. We are extremely proud to have you as our facilitator today, ma'am. We welcome you, please.
So thank you, Mr. Hoare, and the entire team of Aditya Birla Education Academy, particularly Lata, who has been coordinating with me, lending me so much support, and Tiasha, who's also there behind the scenes now. Thank you so much for inviting me to this masterclass. And I must say thank you to all the participants for making time for the session. Because as I said earlier, every time we see there's a webinar, we say, oh no, not again. So this time, this evening, what I want to present or share is no special pedagogy or complicated theories, but I hope it'll be a very simple and a very interactive sharing of ideas and experiences, perhaps over a cup of tea. If you have a cup of tea close by, please go ahead and enjoy your evening tea while we chat. I feel more than ever, the connect, the compassion in our classes is what we need when we connect with our students virtually. So I will speak today, not as principal. Thank you for all those glowing words of tribute that you used to introduce me, Mr. Hoare. But I wish to speak today not as a school leader, but as a teacher, because essentially that is who I am, a teacher at heart. Before I begin, a warm round of congratulations to all principals, teachers, and students for the ISC and the CBSE results that have been declared recently. I'm sure the students have fared well, and they are now ready to move on. It sets me wondering how we have changed since the last session. The post-COVID so-called new normal has opened up a confusing world in which so much has changed with the social distancing norms that are here to stay, but with opportunities in every threat. As we can see today through this webinar, we are connected. I don't know where you are, what is your location, what is your city, but the fact that we are sitting together and chatting tells me that learning must no longer be confined to the school campus. But it may be, and it may be accessed from anywhere, because the barrier of physical space and time no longer exists thanks to technology. And this is the first step to acceptance. Now that we've accepted the new normal, we are slowly, I think, all of us moving to the path of recovery with resilience, strength, and with technology as our tools by our side. There is a lot of fear. There is a lot of uncertainty in the air. And therefore, I think it is crucial more than ever before for us teachers to retain the personal touch, to stay connected with our children, to generate awareness and response to the many issues that are surfacing, using our creativity, using our intellect, because we are teachers, but never, never forgetting the teacher's heart. As an English teacher, I will take recourse to Charles Dickens's Tale of Two Cities and quote him, where he says, "These were the best of times and these are the worst of times." Because there is isolation, but we have technology. We have social media keeping us connected. And in fact, teachers and school leaders, it is our ability to adapt and change that will help us survive this phase. And to take you back to schools and campuses, let me share with you a very short video of Mahadevi Birla World Academy, our school located in Kolkata, for us to see how the campus has changed, how the campus that used to be teeming with noise and bustle and the sounds of children's activities is now silent. But slowly, we are getting ready. We are preparing ourselves to welcome the children back whenever the time is right. Can I have the video, please?
Good morning. Good morning and welcome.
Thank you so much. I think, yes, indeed, we shall overcome because we are all learning to learn again. And I'm sure this video left us all feeling very, very nostalgic for our schools and our campus. We are all learning to learn all over again. And our virtual class is a much needed escape for all of us because it gives us a break from the mundane, the same old. It gives us purpose, routine, and structure. And it helps us retain our identity. So at the very outset, I wish to salute all the teachers and let us take a peek into the teacher's brain at midnight. Because no artificial intelligence, no hole in the wall, no computer, no technology can replace the brain of the teacher and the teacher's heart. So let us salute the superhuman effort of teachers working 24/7 to stay connected with students and their welfare at all times. Indeed, teachers, it is our job more than ever before to be compassionate, to look and listen, and in the process, learn a little bit more about each other. So even as we take our classes online, we will have to stop and check whether videos are on or off, whether the child is playing truant, ask if Mahum is again missing from class, why is she absent? Ask them questions that will make them feel important and give them points to ponder upon and use lots of conversation and humor. My next slide, which tells us how our classrooms must indeed have a room with a view. What is this view? This view is indeed the connect with the real world, world outside. So why is it difficult now to retain our classrooms with a view? You see, the problem is because now we are far away from our students, separated by distances. We are really not trained for this. Earlier, we had all 30 or 40 students in our classroom, together in one space for us to reach out to. It was far easier to get them to come down during break or to go to the playground to connect and to have a connect with real time, real world issues. We are not trained for this indeed. But then again, we teachers are artists who must create citizens of the world, and thus this classroom with a view is so important, whether it is virtual or not. It has to labor, it has to effort, pay effort to provide a realistic view of the world as it changes before our eyes. Teachers, I'm sure you realize that we are at the crossroads of history, and our young learners must be sensitized to the challenges and gifts of this new reality, as well as build skills and competencies now to tackle it with application and technology as their tools for survival. CBSE has declared this year for the year of competency building, and we must all work together to build competencies to help our children cope with the new normal. My next slide. So why connect? Why is this connect even more important today? And this brings me to the four stakeholders of the education teaching learning process. And the slide which says, save me from boredom by engaging, engaging, and engaging. As we all know, there are four important stakeholders in the teaching learning process, but our roles are fast changing. At the top is the principal, who's the pedagogical leader, who of course must be aware of educational trends and creative methods. She, in fact, or he is the leader in the whole process of change and dynamic pedagogy. But the principal too has to change now, for he or she has to train, ignite, and inspire teachers to follow experiential methods, to cultivate skills, and also provide much needed emotional anchorage to both teachers and students. There are days when teachers reach out to the principal saying that there's a problem at home. This is where the principal will also have to reach back, saying that this connect is there for us to feel empowered in strength as a family. So the principal must also give time to the team to catch up with the new trends in technology to navigate the new normal. My next slide, the teacher juggler. The teacher who's always been the master juggler, because the teacher has been the guide, the leader, the father, mother, storyteller, planner, counselor. And he or she is the one who can customize the teaching learning process and design lessons according to the needs of his or her students for better application and for real life connect. And for this, the first thing is that the teacher has to know his or her students, once again, with the emotional connect, the human touch, and the compassion that distinguishes the teacher from the computer. This is not easy, because the new session has begun with our children moving to a new class without us having met them. So we have to use every skill up our sleeve to establish this connect so that we get to know our children slowly. Let's look at parents now. I don't have a slide for this, but it is a known fact that parents are very important stakeholders, but they are very often made to feel that they're outside the circle of learning. Once again, the room that includes, the room that connects them is so important now, because we need parents to participate in this journey of learning, to groom their children to become joyful learners. They have to be trained, they have to be counseled to keep the home joyful for good learning. And they have to become partners in this process, not adversaries. For the home is now the extended classroom. And parents are becoming teachers, counselors, and storytellers along with us. Above all, parents must also learn to relax with us and not to be in this competition race for their children to compete for that elusive half mark for the number one rank. Am I visible?
Ma'am, if you can just lift the camera a little bit.
Yeah. Lift it a little bit. Is that better?
No, a little higher. A little higher.
Okay, 1 minute. Yeah. I'll have to just change the position. Does this help?
Yes, ma'am. That's better. Thank you.
Because I can't see myself, therefore.
This is better, ma'am. Thank you.
This is better. Okay. This 1 minute. I just lost track. 1 minute. Yes, I was talking about parents remaining connected, because they too must learn to navigate the new normal with us. because virtual classroom is something where parents have to remain connected and we have to help them navigate from anywhere, as barriers of space are no longer there for us to remain connected. Just give me a moment. Just give me a moment while I find my track. Yeah.
No problem.
Yeah. Yes. So the teacher has to be valued as the new mentor, as well as the student has to be given opportunity to learn, to reflect, and to connect with the classroom for the learning to become realistic and the learning to become competency-based. The next slide, which tells you about the view outside. Unfortunately, I think we've moved on from the student to the view outside. Unfortunately, yeah, the pressure cooker view, please. What are they going to see outside is something which is baffling at times, because really it is not a very pleasant view. There is fear, there is uncertainty, there is chaos, and it's pretty much like a pressure cooker containment zone waiting to greet us outside the window of our classroom. And to make this clear, I would like to share a story, because stories do help us learn better. So a few weeks ago, we decided to cook more pressure cooker one-time meals to ease the resource and the time on the kitchen, because we were now balancing domestic chores with class time. So the old pressure cooker that was there in the kitchen was outdated, and we thought we'll buy a new one. The new one was brought in, and while trying to assemble the pressure cooker, after many efforts, we realized that the design was confusing because the two pieces were not fitting, they were not aligning. And then this is when I was asked to look at the pressure cooker, because there was a problem and the two pieces were not fitting. So the new version had me completely baffled at the outset. And after I looked at it for a couple of seconds, I had beads of sweat on my forehead. I decided I had to sit down and apply my mind to understand whether the two pieces and how they're going to fit. After fighting with it for quite some time, I decided to sit down comfortably and apply my mind. 10 minutes later, the pressure cooker was ready to start steaming with the new meal that was to be cooked for dinner that evening. It's because I took some time for quietness and reflection. I looked at the application manual, and then once my mind kicked in, my hands stopped working without purpose or planning or direction. This is the moral of the story today, that too much misdirected action does not result in anything other than a lot of sweat. Too many people trying to do a job with the best intention does not help either. What is needed sometimes is to press the pause button, to have time for research and reflection, to understand what needs to be done, and then to apply your mind, swing into action, but planned action versus mindless frenzy. The pressure cooker moment was our first few weeks in lockdown, the environment of fear, of uncertainty, with so much newness to navigate, no time to pause or think, working long hours. But the turning point came when we thought of spending some quiet time, me time, in reflection. Thankfully, I'm sure teachers and principals, we are all now back in alignment, and everything is slowly finding its place in the new post-COVID new normal. So we are here today to remind ourselves to take some time off, to find the alignment, to start connecting with the new normal, to help our young learners learn to cope with the fear and uncertainty that surrounds them. The next slide, which says, Siti Bajao, Khana Tayyar Ho Raha Hai, Thoda Vakt Lagega. So this is what we need to realize, that we need to give ourselves time to let off steam, to cope with stress. We must not allow uncertainties and situations to get to us. It's okay to want to be alone at times, because there are so many pressures that we have to deal with. But at the same time, we need to remember that our children's worlds have also gone topsy-turvy. Let's not add to their buildup of pressure, and let's try to take one day at a time. Homes must be joyful, because the children will learn better when they're happy at home, and when the school campus, no longer being an escape for them, the virtual classroom becomes such an escape. Your virtual class window, once it opens, is really an escape for the children, because our naughty ones can no longer hide away from us in the washroom. they can no longer have a disagreement with a friend and share tiffin the very next moment. These were very, very important activities during school day, much more important than the math or the physics class. From frantic action to a state of flow, my next slide. So slowly, we will find ourselves moving from frantic action to a state of flow with relaxation, with reflection time, and once we realize that students are also stressed and we need to allow them to do the so, to do the same. We are indeed the asli heroes of this phase, and why not clap for all us teachers because we have accepted the new normal and we are learning to navigate it and survive at all cost. Indeed, the next slide which says acceptance is the road to recovery. Let's take another pause and look at a video of the Idea mobile ad, Abhishek Bachchan as the brand ambassador. Let's take a pause and look at the video before we talk about it in the minutes past the video.
अरे अरे अंदर कहाँ आ गए?
बच्चे को स्कूल में पढ़ाना है,
एडमिशन फुल है।
चलिए भाई साहब, गांव में स्कूल नहीं है
तो कैसे पढ़ेगी
मेरे पोती को? भर्ती को
गांव में स्कूल नहीं है तो कैसे पढ़ेगी? अरे वो पढ़े
एक स्कूल में सबको कैसे पढ़ाऊं? आइडिया
student of the year is Lakshmi Raga.
What an idea, Sarji.
So isn't this exactly what we are doing, dear teachers? When the video came out years back, we dismissed it as something which was absurd, but this is exactly what we are doing today, trying to connect with technology at our doorstep. This brings me to my next slide, the new normal. Look at the newspaper image that is there before us. The newspaper image that says worship on wheels, adhering to the new social distancing norms. This was a picture in the Telegraph newspaper that I saw recently that was really inspiring. It was a congregation of people assembling to pray together, keeping social distancing norms in place. What an idea. And this is what brings me to the next part of my topic today, the view that matters most. Connecting with the affective domain, that is the emotional connect, the real connect that matters, that we must retain now, come what may. The question is how. So the answer for me lies in the two E's, to engage and to enjoy. With less teacher talk and lots of space for reflection, as well as integrated co-curricular holistic activities to give them opportunities to explore and enjoy. When I ask my students, sometimes during online classes, what is it that they look forward to in their online time with teachers, they always reply, conversation. What is it that they miss most? Their co-curriculars, their physical activities, their bonding, and their sharing. They really miss school, and so do we. And what we miss the most is the human touch, the personal connect, the conversations in the staff room, the sharing of food, our children sneaking tiffin in between classes, looking out for the teacher on red alert saying, "Wo aa rahi hai." They miss the annual concert, the fests, the carnival, and so on. You know, our class 12s are wondering whether they will ever be able to get back on campus in time for their farewell. Their dreams have been replaced by stress, by anxiety and uncertainty. They miss it all so much that they are now wearing their uniforms with pride during the online sessions. So important for sanity to stay connected. Because for the rest, we have Google Class, we have Diksha, we have Khan Academy, we have Swayam Prabha and so on. The list is endless. So it is the emotional connect rather than marks and grades and IQ that is most important in these days of distancing. CBSC has taken the lead by reducing the syllabus by 30% to emphasize that what is more important is to stop worrying about the learning gaps and to think about how our children will cope with this anxiety, this uncertainty and change. The only way, teachers, to make this happen is to have interdisciplinary connects with music, art, drama, sports and lessons taught, even in our virtual sessions, as necessary tools for engagement and competencies. Can our children breathe? Can they meditate? Can they relax, experience tenderness, trust, and find themselves? If the home and the school are not connected, then our classes are without soul or caring, and the young ones will continue to miss the comfort of campus life. Slide number 8. Sometimes to stop in our tracks and to use emojis and icebreakers to bring in energy in the classroom, because our students sometimes have their attention span is less than a goldfish's. They're really adept at using emojis to denote their state of mind. So why not tell them how you're feeling today by using emojis? If you have the emoji option in your phones, please feel free to tell me how you're feeling today by showing me an emoji connect that will tell me your state of mind in the classroom. Very often, chat sessions with the students, talking to them about your previous school life, about your naughty days, will get them a response like no other. The next slide, number 9, which says, shoes can tell, tick and talk. So we have different kinds of children in the classroom. We have the athletic ones, we have the relaxed ones, we have the naughty ones, we have the fashionable, stylish divas. So why not tell them to talk about their personalities by choosing their favorite pair of shoes, tick and talk, choose their favorite pair of shoes to denote their personalities and talk about it. My next slide, 2 truths and a lie. Yet another icebreaker activity that can be used in the classroom where children may be asked to post 2 truths about themselves and a very cleverly designed lie. And it is for the others to detect which is the truth and where lies the lie. Let's look at another activity that we can design and do together for our children. The next slide, the acronym for COVID. So COVID is the new normal that is staring us in the face. Why not use the chat box and give options for COVID to frame our own acronym, where C could become challenges or communication despite the challenges. Please feel free to use your chat boxes to denote other options, other ideas for the various letters that form COVID. For me, the O is always about opening windows to give them a view of what is outside. V is of course the virus and the reality, the protection that we need to take to stay negative for COVID, but positive for everything else. I is introspection and me time. And D is to will to defeat the disaster, come what may. Slide number 12, an activity that we can try together here as well as with our students. So let's draw together. Why not tell the children to take pieces of paper just at the beginning of the class and to try and draw something as simple as a cat together, but with their eyes closed or with their less dominant hand, and try and have fun with the weird shapes, the lopsided eyes and ears of the cats that emerge. We could also tell them to imagine a path with, on their maybe route from home to school, stopping every time they see something on the way that draws their attention. Maybe a flower seller, maybe the candy man outside the school, to draw symbols for these signs that they see on their way from home to school, and then to talk about it as an emotional unbottling. The next slide, building bridges with reality. So what must we use? Of course, interest, of course, attention, sensitivity, empathy, so that our children lose self-consciousness and are able to speak about themselves and their opinions can be expressed with a lot of conviction. For this, preparation is the key. The online teaching model must be embedded with an emotional compass more than anything else, because mental health issues are also pinnacling and the dominoes effect will be felt very soon. So we must arouse interest and keep focus by using simple activities and opinions, questions that will help them think. Design thinking for change is the need of the hour. For instance, many of our students have been keeping lockdown journals with photographs of the city in lockdown. So why not use photographs of the city in lockdown, silent, quiet, alone, beautiful, that will help them reflect and share their own situations without fear and with hope. Activities and questions about color preferences for boys and girls. So let's start a conversation about what is their favorite color and the standard response of pink for girls or blue for boys, or their favorite dolls, toys that are dolls for girls or video games for boys, or statements like boys are better at computers but girls can cook, or nursing is a profession for girls, will get them to argue with passion and help cultivate gender sensitivity at their levels. Brainstorming on personal strengths and weaknesses, or using a digital Samarpan box to share weaknesses, will help in generating tolerance, respect, and kindness for one another. We could use film clips to make the children aware about the issues of the migrant workers or about racial tolerance to start such activities and discussions in the classroom. I'm sure all of us are doing it. Morning assemblies, thought for the day, role plays, storytelling, job shadowing for the older students, and involving parents in the process will help them stay engaged and stay connected. Most children enjoy cooking, so why not let them be master chefs for the day? Cooking with supervision, of course, in the kitchen, with the kitchen becoming their laboratories as they watch, observe, and participate. The joy of cooking with its attendant traumas and seeing the various changes that the ingredients have to undergo will be a whole new experience for them, a life skill too. One that they will enjoy and value the next time they turn up their noses and complain about food being boring. My next slide is about connecting the cognitive and the affective domains. So we have to use active methods and playway techniques. We have to use sequencing for a pattern to emerge. We have to use reading, research, reflection, preparation, and planning. But we must accept the fact that it is the affective domain that makes them competent, that helps them build the right attitude, beliefs, and value systems for the emotional balance that is so very important for social integration. So a student in your class who's very bright but has anger management issues, we teachers will have to try and interpret the signs and identify and nurture the child carefully so that he is better accepted by friends and peers. So share experiences with them to tell them that they're not alone. In fact, children all over the world are using the online window to connect, to create, and to share. And if current times are tough, it is the same for all. Confinement need not be a condition of the spirit, because we can all be free if we wish ourselves to be. Follow the design think pedagogy with creative inputs and use of the imagination in the forefront. Encourage students to learn through trial and error, as we are doing, to gather information, to make time for analysis and reflection, and then to encourage students to create alternative methods of action and resources using their intuition, using imagination and experience as guiding lights. Above all, creative freedom is important for children to learn with reflection and self-learning opportunities. Another good idea is to merge clubs and the co-curriculars with their academic routine. No need to keep them in separate boxes anymore, because the world is a holistic entity and there is absolutely no need, it's not desirable to keep these activities in separate boxes. So let them plan and execute virtual assemblies, special days, and make fitness videos for their peers to follow. Schools and learners all across the world have been leveled with the virus, with the same kind of problems and technology available to most. And where there isn't enough, I think this is where we teachers, we school leaders must innovate and make the most of what is available. Just like the sermon beamed over loudspeakers, or the village lessons in a district taught over loudspeakers, as was featured in the Times of India recently, gives us a lot of hope. So we must plan lessons with less frills, with less fuss, and make the method engaging. Because what matters is the quantity of what is taught and not the quality. Traditional methods of learning and assessment must be replaced by techniques that are engaging and age appropriate. Save them from boredom. Use your charisma, add masala. there are plenty of resources out there. There is Pinterest, there is Minecraft, there are the CBSE resources, there is the new manuals that have come out, the Cogito manuals that have come out that help you design so many activities with application and problem solving skills that are tested for the children. Let's try reverse mentoring. So we could flip the class because our children can really teach us a thing or two about using technology and also about repackaging content. We can use stories, we can get the children to tell us ideas and stories, and we can break the lesson up into concepts with the children collaborating and presenting and the teacher being the facilitator to fill up the gaps where they appear. The next slide, or the community connect. It is indeed the context that matters. So if it is COVID, if it is racial disparity, if it is migrant workers or mental health, or linking issues to generate responses, try to connect with films, with music, with theater, with sports, to find engaging metaphors to make them aware of social issues and contexts that are out there. Have sessions with a purpose. For instance, while teaching poetry, while teaching Ozymandias, I would take them to a virtual visit now, as doors have opened all over the world, to the museum at Cairo, and to get them to speak and reflect on how time is the only constant and everything else is fragile and ephemeral, generating so many responses. There is indeed so much that needs fixing. There are questions of race, domestic violence, class conflicts, economic meltdown, all rearing their ugly heads. And some of us teachers, learners, parents, students are also caught into it, locked at home. So start conversations. Let them create projects and portfolios on issues such as these, if we are dealing with middle and senior students, and treat them as assessments with many efforts, many attempts made at perfection. Give them points to reflect and ponder upon, and always look for solutions, because despondency can never be the answer. As Mr. Hoare said at the very beginning of this session, it's not easy. To manage screen time, to plan lessons, to balance life skills, activities, sports, in this virtual domain, with loss of direct connect and interaction, with loss of campus space, with the children submitting assignments online and us poring over the screen, correcting online, it's really not easy. But when we say we love our students or we love school, we need to find time for the thing that we love most. And as I said before, there is so much generosity with technology opening doors and resources available for us all to share and learn from one another. So what are some of the tools that we need? My next slide. Talking of tools, planning is, of course, at the top. Planning is key. We have to integrate play for purpose and for fun and give them a lot of creative freedom with appreciation and with encouragement. We keep hearing about Bloom's taxonomy. So why not make Bloom's taxonomy real with creative assignments and assessments planned, keeping it sequential, keeping it simple. So if we are talking of design think pedagogy, the ideation, the creative inputs are what is important. The beauty, the perfection of the finished design is not. So many are creating resources. Many are creating podcasts, games, audio plays, video journals. But let us try and help them identify the objective. Why are they creating these? And then try and map the outcome with our learning design. Most importantly, I think we need to try and make our classes safe zones for trust and sharing to blossom so that children can share opinions without fear of judgment. My next slide, which says use humor. Humor is therapy. There are times when we become so serious, so profound. As teachers, we need to share a laugh or two. We can talk to them about our childhood days, about days when we were naughty or we would get punished by teachers, because it's hard for students to imagine us teachers as being naughty and on the receiving end. This slide, which shows you the humble mask that has been reinvented for multi-purpose use, would indeed make them laugh and reflect on the new normal once again. The next slide, which talks about the legacy that we must leave them with. So what is this legacy that we are talking of? The legacy is the coping mechanism, and above all, the gift of hope with the creativity that helps connect. Hard times such as these help us appreciate our blessings and also help us empathize with others. So let our children feel lucky. help them remember these strange times with imagination by their side. It was not all bad. So let them remember the family time, the wonderful meals that they shared at evening dinner time, perhaps cooked by their fathers for a change, and the relaxed comfort of their online classes. Let us adults worry about bills unpaid, school fees, and whether the world will ever resemble its former self. Let us cope with stress. Let the children's biggest fears be how to defend their toys from their siblings now that everybody is at home all the time. Let them remember going up to the terrace to watch the stars in the evening or clear blue skies. Perhaps our young ones will remember the quarantine as neighbors disguised as masked ninjas, or they will remember very, very precious memories of family karaoke evenings, or pajamas all day longs on weekends, or empty lanes, banging pots and pans, and the green resurfacing all over again. So while we adults are learning the art of patience and resilience, while we learn to navigate the uncertainty, we learn to deal with technology, reinventing ourselves all over again, our children are learning to read, to write, to create, and use technology in a way that is positive and connecting. We are, of course, the lucky ones, with food on our table, a roof over our head, and support all around. Help them recognize their fortune. Help them be grateful. But also, let them be 5 or 10 or 15 because they are children. Let us spare them the pain, as though the hurt of being away from school without a proper goodbye is real. The boredom can be frustrating, and the longing for friends is valid. So please, please let them hold tighter to the memories of precious sunsets, and let them face the new reality with us by their side. There will be bad days for us as well. So share your bad day stories with them, for there will be days when you will miss dressing up for work, going to school, and greeting colleagues. They do too. Tell them it's okay to have a bad day. This too will pass. And there is history to share stories of human resilience that will inspire and heal. Let's try something together. Let's look at the next slide, which is a poem by Rudyard Kipling, a poem called If, which I'm sure all of us are familiar with, either having learnt it when we were young or as teachers teaching it at some level to our students. And let's look at the part which says, if you can make one heap of all your winnings and risk it all in one turn of pitch and toss and lose and start again at your beginnings and never breathe a word about your loss, if you can force your heart and nerve and sinew to serve your turn long after they are gone and so hold on when there is nothing in you except the will which says to them, hold on. Life lessons, life skills cannot get better. My second poem, extract, which is a letter from Abraham Lincoln to his son's teacher. And let's come to the part where he asks the teacher to teach his son to be gentle with people, tough with tough people. Tear him away from envy if you can and teach him the secret of quiet laughter. Teach him if you can how to laugh when he's sad. Teach him there is no shame in tears. Teach him there can be glory in failure and despair in success. Teach him to scoff at cynics. Teach him if you can the wonder of books, but also give him time to ponder the extreme mystery of birds in the sky, bees in the sun, and flowers on a green hill. Teach him to have faith in his own ideas, even if everyone tells him they are wrong. I think this is what we teachers are meant to be doing rather than just transacting content in the classroom. I would now like to share with you my learning designs, my lesson plans for 2 of my lessons in poetry that I teach my class 12 elective English students. One is on Kubla Khan. And if we look at the activities or the projects that are designed, please note how I have tried to use Benedict Cumberbatch's audio clip, his rendition of the poem, to add interest to the children's understanding. Then I've used a film clip from Twilight for the children to appreciate the supernatural element which is pervading the poem. And then I've used a film song from Mehel, Our Times, for the children to appreciate the haunting eeriness, the melody that resonates in the entire poem and its structure. And then for activities, I told them to talk about, through a comparative analysis of Milton that is there in their syllabus and Coleridge, the poetic mission of through the vision statement, and to reflect on what gives us permanence. Is it wealth or art, wealth or creative genius? And then once again, I had told them to find themselves as an artist who has created their masterpiece, and to create a podcast for the press to celebrate the release of their artwork and to celebrate their journey as an artist. My second lesson plan is on Evelyn, a short story by James Joyce, where I have used Frank Sinatra's song, My Way, to get the children to relate with choices that they always have in life. And then for assignment and assessment, I had told them to construct a dialogue between them and their parents about an unconventional career choice using an audio play format. So it's possible to break the lesson up into segments, into concepts, and to design assessments that are creative and interactive rather than the simple comprehension, rote memory question and answers. The next slide is on a junior activity that was tried by our junior teachers, where they used role play and art integration to indicate the differences between then and now, with students acting as reporters and interviewing their parents and grandparents. The next activity is interesting because it uses hand mapping for the children to describe their personalities. So it's a creative way of describing their personalities. As I said, the children are new to us. Many have come to a new class in the new session without us getting to know them better. So if they could mention their names, their likes, their dislikes, their strengths, their weaknesses, their plans for the future using a hand mapping exercise, it will help us to get them know a little better and them to speak about themselves with creativity and with interest. The next slides are on math activities designed by our teachers. Oh, I'm sorry. There's another slide, which is the value on time, where I had used mapping this to a poem in their syllabus called On Time by Milton, where I had asked the children to indicate the 24 hours in their day on a page with 24 squares, indicating the time that they spend fruitfully and the time wasters, so that they put a value on time spent and they eliminate the time wasters. This was something that they did with a lot of honesty and sincerity to understand for themselves what is wasting time. The next slides are on math activities designed by our math teachers for middle school, where they have used linear equations to show the transmission of COVID in a population. And then again, math activities in the next slide, which integrate art, where children are asked to find quadrilaterals in the shapes that surround them using photography. That brings me to the next slide, with our windows wide open, saying reality beckons. And what is this new reality? Once again, to go back to a collage of photographs of people bravely navigating the new normal. People in PPE suits, my next slide, please. Doctors, frontline workers, people with masks and face shields, traveling distances, migrant workers, people braving adversity, accepting and moving on to the path of recovery. The next slide is funny because it's one of our teachers trying to keep the class going with whatever tools she has at her disposal. Class must carry on. Bringing in all that has been said about the emotional, cognitive, and community, let's hear from our students. This is not about propaganda, but I think what we are pitching is essentially for our students. And I'm sure what our students have to say will resonate with all of you, because all of us are trying. All of us are trying every trick, every skill up our sleeve to reach out to our students and to connect. So let's hear it from our children.
For the last few months, life in quarantine has been anything but easy for all of us, especially for us 12th graders who have been missing out on such precious school time. And this ultimately led to the introduction of online classes. And it would not be wrong for me to say that our online classes have been successful in tackling the most apprehensive situation, the loss of the bond between a teacher and a student. Apart from the precise textual explanation and text application, our online classes include exchange of thoughts, ideas. Our virtual space is our safe space of expression. Our teachers share with us their personal experiences, their personal anecdotes, which ultimately encourages us as well to talk to them about our problems or about anything good that happens with us. This informal discussion also makes room for several debates where we exchange so many different things with each other, and this has actually strengthened the bond between our preceptors and us as learners.
A classroom is like a safe haven where we are no longer judged for our opinions or mistakes but encouraged. During this lockdown, when we no longer have the privilege of having blackboards in our class, we have the gift of technology guiding us. In our English elective class, our teacher uses songs, videos, and activities to help us establish the real-life connect. We all sympathize with the plight of the migrant workers. The Girl in the Pink Frock by Anurupa Roy helps us harden the reality and the truth. A poem in a syllabus called The Divine Image by William Blake and its contrast, The Human Abstract, educates us in the importance of having a choice.
We decided to organize an online workshop. This online workshop would be hosted by the 12th graders for the middle and senior secondary students for them to interact and leave behind a rich legacy for their juniors. These online workshops would include extempo, debate, art, dance, music, and many more of such creative workshops, and also life skills sessions conducted through Zoom. This would help the students of our school gain a new perspective and outlook of their lives in times of such pandemic.
The Food ATF Anytime Food was an initiative that we kickstarted in 2018, and we have been beautifully sustaining it for 2 years now. However, the current circumstances are not allowing us to physically go out there and help the people who were benefiting from this. So to make sure that even though so much has come to a standstill given the pandemic, our work as active citizens in the society does not stop, we will now be shifting the work of the ATF to an online platform. We are steadily working towards an online fundraiser to support the work that we were doing previously. The ATF is a legacy left behind by our previous students, and we are working very hard to make sure that it withstands the test of time and remains inexhaustible. We at Mahadevi Birla World Academy strongly believe in small acts of kindness to make a difference in people's lives. To make sure that the fundraiser is a success, we are promoting it by working on creative visuals, posters, and captions that resonate with people and motivate them to donate to this cause.
The whole world is in the midst of a turmoil right now, and we cannot deny the fact that the current situation is here to stay. Learning is not just limited to the four walls of the classroom, and this quarantine absolutely validates the statement. This quarantine has enforced us to work more and to explore ourselves as human beings and work harder as students. It has expanded our thinking and made us leaders of today and not tomorrow. As students, we have learned to relate to things even better. Therefore, this was only possible because we could accept the situation and find ways to tackle it. It is only when we have the ability to accept that we can have the resilience to recover.
Thank you so much. And I think many of you will resonate because all of us are trying to do the same things using technology, using the resources that are there at hand. Bringing all that has been said together to conclude, let me conclude by narrating something I watched recently on Netflix, a series of films entitled Homemade. And thank God for Netflix, it has helped us stay afloat during the lockdown. The lockdown has reduced us all to a common denominator. For with no crowds, reduced traffic, no concerts, graduation days, or large celebrations, everyone is now at home, trying to avoid the strange virus. We are fragile. We are bending to the whims of the universe, with nature reminding us how small we are. And now, since we must all stay home, our perspective for teaching learning must change. We will have to find new ways to keep the blood flowing and to feel free. Art is a new perspective to something familiar, a new look, a new definition. To add freshness to the work of somebody is the work of an artist, and we teachers are artists as well. Our familiar lives must now be reconstructed with a new attitude in place. Yes, we miss our work, the comfort of routine, the comfort of structure, and we miss our friends. We are afraid. So are the children. So why not turn fear into the motivator, into the architect, as it sometimes is? Life is scary, but planning makes it comfortable and we could be back in control. After all, we are home now. It could have been much worse. The last slide, which says, I write, erase, rewrite, erase again, and then a poppy blooms. Let us reinvent to be real. Let us rewrite rule books, add kindness, offer choices, and keep connecting till the poppies bloom in our classroom. The rainbow is bound to rise again. As Maya Angelou said, as teachers, let us try to be the rainbow in someone's cloud. Thank you for listening. Thank you so much for listening and for being such a patient audience. I'm open to questions if there are any. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. Participants, you can put in your questions in the chat box. Ma'am, we already have a couple of questions from participants on Facebook. There is a teacher who's asking if you could elaborate a little bit on activities that can be done for primary school specifically.
Okay. So, though I teach in the middle and in the senior, primary school children also can be engaged doing a lot. For instance, the worksheets that are now being designed for them could be made interactive and creative. It could be interpreted differently. I was just telling you about the CBSE alternative calendars, and there is this book called Cogito, which is there on the CBSE website. It is a new sharing of resources where at every level, they are showing how comic strips can be created by children or for children to get them to think about questions and activities in a more rational, more practical manner with problem solving and skill integration. So there are many resources there. There is another resource called Minecraft. There is Pinterest, where teachers can visit to create worksheets with a difference, activity worksheets presented in a very engaging manner for students. For example, the children are asked to keep lockdown journals in class 5. Well, they could also imagine their parents as superheroes. So the mother or the father could be shown wearing a cape, and then the children could be asked to write 2 sentences on that. So it could be something which is more imaginative and creative, as I said, using the resources that are there at the doorstep. Minecraft is wonderful because a lot of our boys and girls are into gaming. If I say only boys, then I'm also being gender insensitive. So they're into gaming. So why not use gaming as an inverse activity for them to create such games which will heighten their activity interest levels? Minecraft is a wonderful resource where Lego is there, but it's there interactively where children can enter, play, and then design their own ideas based on the resources that are available. So I hope that answers your question.
Yes, ma'am. There is another participant on Facebook who has said, could you please just reiterate slide 2B again? Can I share the screen, ma'am? It's about the new learner.
Yes, please. Yes. So new learner is somebody who is challenging us because the children are smarter than us. And I have mentioned this before, that when we say try reverse mentoring, the children can very well become peer educators. So the new learner must develop the right attitudes, must have the 21st century skills in place, must have logic, problem solving abilities, and the learning therefore has to be enabled in a manner that addresses skills and concepts rather than rote learning. So for the new learner or the new student, it has to be more collaboration, it has to be more sharing of ideas, it has to be more communication-enabled presentation, and not just sitting and answering questions that are thrown at them without much thought or skill in the picture. So it has to be questions that are designed to challenge the new learner, because the new learner is much smarter than we were at that age. They know a lot more, their exposure is a lot more, and they can surely teach us a thing or two. So that's what I meant by the new learner. the collaborator, the creator, and the communicator. That's your student for you now.
Thank you so much, ma'am. I don't think we have any other questions at this moment from the chat box either. If there are a couple of participants who've raised hands, if you can please put in your question in the chat box. There's very positive feedback, ma'am, from Facebook and from the chat box here for the session.
Thank you so much. Actually, there was some trouble with the camera because I'm also, you know,
That's fine, ma'am. So I think we've all learned to make our peace with technology here. I think
yes. But I hope I was audible and clear throughout because I did try to get across.
Yes, ma'am.
And I'm happy to take questions because this is what I do. I do this every day. I take class. So it's something that stems from my everyday practice. So I'm happy to take questions.
I think we don't have any questions yet. Pradipto sir, are you around? Till then, participants, we've sent out a feedback form in the chat box. Please fill out your feedback. This will help us plan better and prepare better for
the session.
Ma'am, there's a question that's actually come up now on Facebook. How do you guide primary students on self-discovery?
Primary students, how to?
How can we guide them on their path of self-discovery in the primary?
Okay. So no problem. Every time you tell the students to nurture something, to create something, for instance, if you're teaching them a simple concept of ships and how they sail, so it's not important for them to create the ship. When you're telling them to create a model of a ship, it's not important for them to create the model in all its design detail. But it's important for them to collaborate over the kind of materials that they will need so that the ship is light or the boat is light and it can sail. So even if they're making a paper boat, which everybody makes at that childhood, and if you allow them to sail it on a bucket of water, which is available at home now, they can discover for themselves what is it that is making the paper boat sail and not sink. Similarly, a simple exercise like getting them to watch you when you're making tea. The very fact that the water has to boil at the right temperature for the tea to be added so that the right flavor, the right color is what you get out of the right proportion, the balance and the mixing. If you put the tea leaves in cold water, it will never give the right kind of flavor or appearance or color. You wouldn't want to drink that tea. So a simple exercise like that will start the child on a journey of self-learning and discovery. You remember I said, let them cook. So when they see the ingredient changing, the potato, the way it looks before, and when you're frying it or boiling it, it changes completely in appearance. So this whole dynamism of change, you can either express it in a very difficult and complicated manner, or you can put it very simply like an exercise of making tea, which they see mothers doing every day or fathers doing every day. Or they can try making their tea or boiling a potato. And this is what, or even nurturing a plant, the different steps of the growth of the plant when they see it for themselves. Or like I said, sailing a paper boat. All these will help them on the design think pedagogy that I just shared with you. That they start thinking for change, start thinking for designing, implementing change, and discover learning for themselves. So the pieces fit. It's like a jigsaw puzzle and the pieces start fitting. I hope I've been able to answer your question.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, you have. I think Pradipto sir is here. He'll take it from here.
I'm here.
Yes.
I mean, I just can't thank you enough, ma'am, for this wonderful holistic session. Right from motivating teachers and students, highlighting the importance of mental health, sharing lesson plans across subjects and engaging videos, you really connected well to this scenario. Giving the simple example of pressure cooker. Your examples are more student-centric, keeping them at the center of all the activities that we do. And even during the pandemic, we must keep student interest in mind by having conversations, discussions, and one-to-one connections. It was truly a great session.
Thank you so much
for your time. And thank you participants. I think so the time just flew. We didn't even realize it's more than an hour passed by. We didn't even realize that how time just passed by. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so much.
We look forward to have your support again in future.
Thank you so much. And please feel free to share your feedback and questions, if any. I'll be very happy to answer. And if there's anything further that I can engage with, I'm there for you. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Be safe, all of you. Please.
Thank you.
Thank you, participants.